we pray together. Our prayer found in your bulletin. Let us pray. Gracious God, we thank you for all your gifts of creation. Teach us to share with others our time, our energy, our resources, and our love. Make us sensitive and responsive to the wounds in the human family and creation. May we be faithful to our calling and live a long life on earth. May we give our whole life to Christ, for we belong to him, and in him all things are united on earth and in heaven. Amen. Welcome again to St. John's. Thank you, Tom Calhoun, for leading our choir today in Catherine's absence. January 25th will be our next New Member Sunday. If you are new to St. John's, please give us a call or put a note on the friendship pad, and we'll be in touch with you if you would like to know more about membership here. The red books, the friendship pads, are near the center aisle. Please sign those today and pass them down to those near you. Also, Wednesday this week, our Wednesday night suppers resume, so please make a reservation if you do not have one already for that. Every month is Missions Month at St. John's, but January is especially special. The Mission Impact Celebration will be Friday, January the 23rd, 24th, and 25th. The kickoff dinner is January 23rd, and you can make reservations for the dinner online or the cards that you received in the mail. However, there's some corrections on the card. The dinner is Friday, not Thursday. It is the 23rd, and my understanding it begins at 5:30 rather than 6 o'clock. So please come out for that, and we'll see you there. Take your bulletins home and find lots of opportunities this month to serve our Lord. At this time, I invite Mary Jo Wilson Spencer to come forward to present the Applefest checks for 2014.
Good morning. I can't tell you what a pleasure it is to be up here before this great church. I'm here today to thank all the United Methodist women, the United Methodist men, the United Methodist youth. I cannot begin to even try to tell you what a great job you did with our Apple Festival this year. It was just such a pleasure, such fun. It was on November 2. And I have to quote John Wesley. I just love to quote him. And I have to hold the card because I wouldn't quote him if I didn't. I'd say something wrong. But he says that we as Methodists should do all the good you can, all by all the means you can, in all the ways you can, in all the places you can, in all the times you can, to all the people you can for as long as ever you can. And he also says that if you catch fire with enthusiasm, people will come for miles to see you burn. This is what happened on November 2. It snowed, and people came from everywhere to buy and shop and eat and have fun with all of us here at this wonderful church at St. John's. Anyway, today I have the privilege to present a check for $10,000. We've never given this much per recipient. The United Methodist Women, of which I am the president, I'm just why I'm standing up here, we all as circles get together and vote on who we would like to receive the money each year. And this year we voted for Golden Harvest Food Bank, which is headed by Travis McNeil. We voted for the Jack Meeks Ramp Ministry, which is headed by Steve Lathrop, and for Grace Kitchen, which is headed by Bobby Coker. And my wonderful women who did such a fantastic job running this show this year, Carol Parsons, Juanita Bell, and Kay Shirley, will come forward now and present these checks. These ladies were just fantastic. I mean, they really were. Let's give them. Okay, guys, don't be shy. Come on up. We want to see all of your handsome faces. Okay. Bobby Coker with Grace Kitchen. Steve Lathrop. Steve Lathrop, Zach Meek's Rant Ministry. And Travis McNeil, Golden Harvest Food Bank. Thank you so very, very much. We appreciate everything that everybody does. Don't ever think you're not important, because you really are. Thank you.
This morning, our mission testimony spotlights the mission trip that Jan Gilbert and Renee Boylston took to Thailand. And you don't really have to wait even to the MIC to hear more about it, because Jan and Renee will be the guest speakers at Sunny Monday tomorrow, and they meet at 10:30 in Ward Hall. So please join us for Sunny Monday, but also now just take time to watch and listen as Renee talks about how prayer influenced her trip to Thailand. Thank you.
My name is Renee Boylston. I've been a member of St. John's for close to 21 years. A friend of mine, Jan Gilbert, and I went on my first mission trip this summer to Thailand for the Thailand Methodist Ministry. Our mission partners are Mike and Sherry Morrissey. Prayer has been an essential part in preparation for going on a short-term mission trip. Especially for me, there was a period of time in that 18 months prior to going that it looked as if, for different reasons, that I may not be able to go. And I had a sense of peace when I was in communion and prayer that if it were to be so, that would be taken care of. And not only one time was it taken care of, but three or four different times. I would like to share with you the story about Bo. It was a young girl who is from one of the poorest parts of Thailand, in Isan, and was a member of the Blessing Home there, a partner there. The morning after we arrived, we asked Mike, is there a need you have? And he looked at us and said, Bo. She is on a journey to be the first for generations to go to college, and they are providing a scholarship for her. The scholarship is $2,000 that would complete 2 years of college for her to get a nursing degree. Not only will that change her life, but it'll be a generational change. And he said, we had just been in prayer this week on how we would find the funds for that. Her being able to go to college represented to that town as well an opportunity that, a hopeful opportunity, that they wouldn't necessarily be drawn into what is very common, which would be to go to Pattaya and to participate in the sex tourism there at this early age. And the parents are not able to support the family in any other way. So that sense of hopelessness of to watch your 12-year-old daughter go 6 hours away into what you know that's going to represent. So this scholarship for Bo not only represented a way out just for her, but also for that entire community. And the people always asked that we pray for them. Sometimes it was specific requests, and sometimes it was just that we asked for blessings for them. To be prayer partners with those people in their homes was truly amazing.
Build on a rock, build on Jesus and the Word. God's children said, Amen. With joy, let us worship with the Apostles' Creed. Together we confess, I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Let us pray. Oh Lord, we're grateful for the ways that you use us in the midst of our world, a world that flails about seeking meaning and purpose. Sometimes it reveals its pointlessness in anger and frustration, destruction, terrorism. Lord, we pray for peace. We pray for people to come to know you for who you are as Savior, as one who can bring lasting and true peace. Lord, we pray for every person in every country that longs for your grace, that longs for security, that longs for food and shelter, not all the basic necessities of life. Whether they be in Thailand or in France, in the Middle East, or here in Aiken, South Carolina. Oh Lord, we come this day to worship you, to thank you for all the ways that you have blessed us, for the ways that you want to use us. We pray that you might speak to our hearts, that we might hear what your Spirit says and have courage to do what you say. Lord, we pray for those in our congregation and our community that are suffering, those who have lost loved ones, longtime members of this church. We pray for their comfort and pray for their strength. And pray for this, their church family, that you might enable us to so let our light shine that people may see our good deeds and glorify you, our Father in heaven. We pray for those who are undergoing procedures and surgeries, who anticipate therapies for their well-being. We pray for healing, Lord, to rule in the hearts of this congregation, this community. But Lord, rule in all of our hearts. Rule in all of our hearts that we may glorify you, that we may be your witnesses, not only in Jerusalem and in Judea and Samaria, but to the uttermost parts of the world. This is our prayer in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, the one who taught his disciples and us to pray, praying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven, and give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us of our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. And now will the ushers please come forward for our morning tithes and offerings.
People, if you're going to participate in children's church, please follow the crucifer out of the sanctuary. My hope is built. 368.
Thank you. be seated.
Before I read our scripture lesson, I do want to say a word of thanks to the United Methodist women and all the persons involved in Apple Fest. That was my first Apple Fest, and I was so impressed by all of the labors that everyone did. Tremendous outpouring of support. And, of course, the recipients, wonderful ministries, amazing to raise $30,000 on a day that was snowing. Amazing. So I want to say thank you to all of those persons. I also want to say a word of support for the Mission Impact Celebration that will be held in just a couple of weeks. In just a couple of weeks, we will have mission partners that St. John supports from around the world who will be here that weekend, that Friday night celebration. I've not been through one of those either, but this is something that we do together. We not only support the work of the annual conference, the apportionments, and all the missions there, several hundred thousand, all the money that the United Methodist women give, the work that United Methodist men do, but the Mission Impact Celebration is a way that we can offer our support, not only by inviting these persons into our fellowship and being here, hearing their stories of the ways that God has been using them through Jesus Christ around the world on our behalf, but it's a way for us to make faith promises that we will support those missions throughout this coming year. They make a difference, so I want to encourage you that you will be a part of making that difference. E. Stanley Jones, great Methodist missionary, said that when the tide of missions comes in, all the ships rise. So everything we can do, from United Methodist Women, through our church budget, through apportionments, to the annual conference that goes to the general church and around the world, through the United Methodist Men, through the youth, through every avenue of mission in this church, and especially as we think about Mission Impact Celebration, we can have a laser-like focus that can make a positive difference for Jesus in this world. And if we don't believe this world needs it, then we're already in trouble. We know this world needs Christ. So I hope that you will help. Please sign up and be a part of all of the events. Now for our scripture reading. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, starting at verse 9. Paul is writing and he says, "For we are God's fellow workers, you are God's field, God's building. By the grace God has given me, I laid a foundation as an expert builder, and someone else is building on it. But each one should be careful how he builds, for no one can lay any foundation other than the one already laid, which is Jesus Christ. If any man or woman builds on this foundation, using gold, silver, costly stones, or wood, hay, or straw, his work or her work will be shown for what it is, because the day," meaning the judgment day, "will bring it to light. It will be revealed with fire, and the fire will test the quality of each person's work. If what he or she has built survives, he or she will receive their reward. If it is burned up, they will suffer loss. They themselves will be saved, but only as those escaping the flames." This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. Well, I believe all of us at some point or another have heard the story of the three little pigs. I think that story could have been inspired by 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 9 through 15. I can't prove that, but you tell me what you think. Now, you know the story of the three little pigs. You know that there's those three pigs, and each one builds their home. One builds a home made out of straw, one builds a home made out of sticks, and one builds a home made out of bricks. And then there's this big bad wolf that we could say is synonymous with evil, the devil, Satan. And the big bad wolf comes along, and he first approaches the home of the little pig that built his home out of the straw. And he says, little pig, let me in." And the little pig says, "Not by the hair of my chinny chin chin, I will not let you in." And the big bad wolf says, "I'm going to huff and I'm going to puff and I'm going to blow your house in." And his house caves in, made out of straw. And he takes off and runs to the house of the pig who built his house out of bricks. But then the wolf doesn't go to the house made of bricks. He goes next to the pig's house made of sticks. He goes to the pig's house made of sticks and he says, little pig, let me in. And the big bad wolf hears in response from the pig who built his house out of sticks, I will not let you in by the hair of my chinny chin chin. And the big bad wolf says, I'll huff and I'll puff and I'll blow your house in. And he huffs and he puffs and he blows the house in and it falls. Then he goes to the house where all three pigs are gathered, the house made of bricks. And he says to the pig whose house is made of bricks, little pig, let me in. And the pig whose house is made of bricks says, not by the hair of my chinny chin chin. I will not let you in. And the wolf says, I'll huff and I'll puff and I'll blow your house in. And of course, it doesn't fall in because it's made of something more durable than straw or sticks. It's made of bricks. And the wolf says, well, I'll climb on top of your house and I'll come down the chimney. And of course, he does. And there is a hot reception waiting him. And there's the end of the big bad wolf. But there are correlations to my life and your life as we begin this new year of 2015. As we think about the building material with which we will build our lives in this new year. As we think about the foundation that's so important. As we think about life in general, with all of the things that are happening in the world in which we live. Someone put it this way, be careful how you build your house. Everyone has a house to build. Our houses hold our lives, and every moral is a beam. Every window is a dream. Every door is an opportunity, and every roof is protection from the storm. I've heard the story of these two men who were stranded on a desert island. One decided in his wisdom, good thinking, following Matthew chapter 7, where it says, those who hear the words of mine and put them into practice are like the man who built his house upon a rock. And the rains came and they didn't befall that house and make it fall. But there was another man there on that island who decided to build his house on the beachfront and on the sand, which reminds us again of Matthew chapter 7, who, when Jesus said, if you build your house upon the sand, it's like the person who hears my words and does not put them into practice. And when the rains come and the storms arrive, great will be the fall of that house. And so these two men, they have their houses. One has his house up on the cliff overlooking the beach. He thinks everything's going to be fine with his house built upon the rock. But it so happens that the winds would come and the rains would come and they would skip over the area of the beach, but the rain would fall on the house built on the rock on top of the cliff. And so this guy is thinking, okay, God, I've built my house on the rock. I know that your word says that when the rains come and the storms arrive, that if I have my house on the rock, it will not fall. But here I am, patching the roof from the rain all the time and even pumping the basement. And then every now and then he would hear noise from the house from the beach. And he looks over the edge of the cliff and he sees that a cruise ship has decided to stop. And there are dinghies on the beach. And the guy down on the beach is having this grand party and it happens over and over again. And he is up on top of the cliff and he's just got rain after rain after rain and water in the basement and all the rest. And finally, after years of this and waiting on the storm to arrive to wipe away the guy's house on the beach, he says to himself, if you can't beat them, join them. And so he packs up all his belongings. He leaves his house that's built on the rock on top of the cliff. He goes down to the beach and he settles into his bungalow. And that very night, a hurricane and a storm, and the rain, and the destruction. And yes, indeed, the words of Matthew come true. the house built on the sand, great is the fall thereof. But the house built upon the rock still was standing. Too bad nobody was home. And there are many of us, as we face 2015 and we have storms that will buffet our houses, our homes, our lives, and we wonder, why have we continued to trust in the Lord and build our house on the rock, and we're tempted to give in and go along with the big bad wolf and park on the beach and not care? Yes, indeed. Our foundation is important. That's the first thing that comes out of Paul's words in 1 Corinthians chapter 3. Our foundation is not just important, it is of utmost importance. And that foundation, Paul says, is none other than Jesus Christ. We can build our lives on everything we can imagine. But if we don't build our lives on Christ, if we don't build our lives on Jesus and what Jesus can do for us, then it is all for naught. When we think about the big bad wolf and think about how that represents evil and destruction, I'm reminded of 1 John chapter 4, verse 4, where John writes, "Greater is he who is in you than he who is in the world," writing to Christians who are buffeted by storms, who have the big bad wolf howling at their doorstep. Greater is he who's in you than he who is in the world. And when we live in the world in which we live, that has people who are more interested in being spiritual than being religious, who have this vague ambiguity for moral standards, I am reminded indeed of Acts chapter 4, verse 12, where it says, "Salvation is found in no one else. There is no other name given among men by which we must be saved than Jesus Christ." So when we live in this world in which we live, where there's so much uncertainty, there's one thing of which we can be certain, that if Jesus is the foundation of our life, we shall do more than survive. We shall thrive. Do we believe this? Do we have the witness of the Holy Spirit with our spirit, Romans chapter 8, that we are indeed children of God? And if you don't know that this morning, you need to make sure of that before you leave this place of worship. Do you know that you know that you know? Does God's Spirit bear witness with your spirit that your sins are forgiven, that the foundation of your life, of everything about you and your family, is Jesus Christ? There's no more important lesson from this scripture passage. But it does go on to say there are some things that we also need to consider. If Jesus is the foundation, our building materials that we build on top of that foundation are also important. Yes, we are saved by grace. There's nothing we can do to earn salvation. We're saved by grace. But what we do with that grace is important. How we build upon that foundation is important. Someone even dared to say that the heavenly home that we receive if we believe in Christ is going to be built with the materials that we send on ahead through our good works. Yes, we're saved by grace. Make no mistake about it. But we are saved by grace to do good works. Now, fancy what your house might be like in heaven if it depends upon the building materials that you send on ahead. I heard about a pope that had died and went to heaven. And St. Peter said, I need to show you where you're going to be living. And of course, the Pope was thinking he was going to live in some magnificent palace like the Vatican. And St. Peter takes him and shows him this little ramshackle hut-looking shack. But the Pope notices that there's a mansion on the hill nearby. And he says, "Who in the world lives there?" And he could hear the noise of a grand party taking place. "Who lives there?" And the Pope says, "Well, I can't remember his name, but I know he's a lawyer." And the Pope says, well, here I am, a Pope, a Bishop of Rome, a leader of the church, and I get a shack, a hut, and he gets a mansion. He said, well, St. Peter says, well, you got to realize how many lawyers we have, and as opposed to how many popes we have. I cleaned it up a little bit for all you lawyers out there. You know, I've heard all about three nuns, three popes, three bishops, three preachers, and three lawyers. I don't know why we don't have that for accountants. Just good people, I guess. Nevertheless, our home in heaven has its foundation, Jesus Christ. Our home on earth has as its foundation, Jesus Christ. And what we build upon that foundation is important. I'm not saying, indeed, that our home in heaven is made with the building materials we send on ahead, but it does encourage me to do something with the salvation that Jesus has freely given me, though it cost him everything. But some of us, we build with straw. We're like that little pig that built with straw. And the big bad wolf is howling. I'll huff and I'll puff and I'll blow your house in. Yes, we've built with straw. We look like Hosea chapter 8, verse 7, where it says that if we sow the wind, we will reap the whirlwind. What are you sowing? What are you building with? What are we doing with our lives? Are we using cheap materials? Do we lack integrity? I've shared this with you before. Integrity is a great word. It comes from the old French, integer. Integer means to touch. If you have integrity, it means that you have a common core with which all of the different aspects of your life are in touch. Jesus wants to be the hub of our wheel, not just another spoke. To have Jesus as just a spoke is not integrity. The integrity of that wheel will be in question. I am so sick of sportscasters, for instance, talking about the difference between on-the-field excellence and off-the-field antics. When they're talking about Johnny Manziel, Johnny Football, or Jameis Winston, how dare they receive the Heisman Trophy? How dare they receive the Heisman Trophy? Because it does matter whether your on-the-field behavior matches your off-the-field behavior. It matters how your behavior is in church and how your behavior is on the street on Monday. It matters for all of us. And some of us have built our houses out of straw. Some of you may recall Ted Koppel of 2020 fame, ABC, in the news. You may recall he spoke at Duke University's commencement some years ago. But what he said then, I think, says a lot to us now about how we should not build with straw. He says, our culture says that you can do whatever you want, but I tell you the answer is no. Not no because it isn't cool or smart or because you might end up in jail or dying in an AIDS ward, but no because it's wrong. Because we have spent 5,000 years as a race of rational human beings trying to drag ourselves out of the primeval slime by searching for truth and moral absolutes. But in the place of truth, we have opinions for moral absolutes. And we have substituted moral ambiguity for truth. We now communicate with everyone and say absolutely nothing. We have reconstructed the Tower of Babel. Our society finds truth too strong a medicine to digest undiluted. In its purest form, truth is not a polite tap on the shoulder. It is a howling reproach. What Moses brought down from Mount Sinai were not the 10 suggestions. They are the 10 commandments, are, not were, end quote. Oh, how I agree. So some, like the first little pig, build their houses on straw, with straw, and it's not worthy. And then there are others who build their houses out of wood and sticks. Now, wood and sticks is great. I mean, it's good building material. Most of our homes that we live in are stick-built homes. There are a lot of things in our lives that are good, but they may not be best. Stuff. Stuff. Some of you got stuff at Christmas, and you're finding places to put your stuff. But you may not have gotten what was best. I'm not going to call that into question, or the gift givers. You may have given them the list. But our homes are filled with stuff. Now, I will say one thing, at least one thing good about itinerancy, about United Methodist clergy having to move, is that you got to get rid of your stuff every now and then. You got to learn how to travel light. But I'll never forget when we were in our third or fourth appointment, as I'm looking over at my wife, the pastor that we were following had a heart attack and died suddenly. So about 3 or 4 weeks before annual conference, we're having to get our stuff together. And we realize we've got more stuff than we need, and we don't need to carry it with us. And so we come up with a grand idea to have a free yard sale. So at 517 Kershaw Street in Sherrill, South Carolina, as I was serving First United Methodist Church there, we borrowed two or three tables, these nice tables from the church. We put them out on the front lawn, and we put poster board with great artwork, free yard sale. And we put our stuff, not our best things, but our less than best, our wood and sticks, those things that you don't really need. They aren't the best. We put it out there. Well, guess what happened? Somebody took our stuff off the tables and took the tables. Because the tables were really nice. They were better than stuff. And I had to pay the church for those tables. Stuff like wood and sticks, it burns up. And this passage of Scripture says that the judgment day is going to come, and that each person's work will be burned with fire. And if it survives the fire, then that person's work will be saved. It says some person's work will be burned up and they will be saved, but as if they are escaping through the flames. I almost entitled this sermon, Saved But Singed. Because when I look at my life, and perhaps if you look at your life, there's a lot about our lives that are going to be burned up when it's purified through the purging that takes place before we enter the pearly gates at the judgment. Saved but singed. We need to work, for the night is coming, the old hymn says. Judgment day is coming. There's going to be a payday someday. Do you want your house to be built of straw? Do you want your house to be made of sticks, that which is good but not best? Or do you want your house made of the best? Now, like a good wooden-sided Cape Cod. I went to seminary in Boston. You don't see bricks up there very often. But if you want to have something sturdy, even the Egyptians taught the Israelites that, you better stick with bricks. Solid, good, spiritual building material. There are some things that Christians in any context don't do, and there are some things that every Christian in every context should do. And we need to know the difference. We need to have our lives built upon that foundation of Jesus Christ, our Savior. We need to have our lives built with the best. Bricks, even. Proverbs 29:18, it says, when there is no vision, the people perish. What's our mission statement? What's your mission statement? What's the mission statement of the church? Someone said that mission statements need to be long enough to be memorable and short enough to be memorized. There's something very true about that. And as I was reading this week in preparation for the sermon, I read about the one word 2015 challenge. The one word 2015 challenge. That we should pick one word upon which to focus for the whole year. Now, that word, if we were to think about bricks, things that are durable, things that are good, things that represent Jesus, our foundation, you might want to think of a word like one of the words in the list of the fruit of the Spirit in Galatians chapter 5, verse 22. The fruit of the Spirit is love. What if that was your one word for 2015? Love. That you put on your refrigerator, that you put on your computer monitor, that perhaps you did a mirror image so it would be on your eyeglasses, at least one lens. Love, joy, peace, patience, goodness, gentleness, faithfulness, self-control. Or like the flags that I see flying around Aiken, joy, generosity. There are other flags. I've seen them just in the last few days. What are words that you would select? What are words that you would select? I was listening to Casting Crowns, a contemporary Christian music group. And their song just keeps going over and over again in my mind. And it might be the word for me. The word is thrive. It's time for us to more than just survive. God made us to thrive. Let me share with you from the Chicago Tribune, the author, Mary Schmidt, who wrote this past week about this one word movement. Because I want the good Lord to speak to you. We got the foundation settled. The foundation is right. It's Jesus. But what's going to be your one word for 2015? I want the Lord to speak to you. Listen and listen. Not just to me, but to the Lord. If you were to pick one word to guide your new year, what would it be? Having to answer that question is like being dropped off inside a Super Target store and asked to pick one object and only one that you would carry with you for the next 12 months. Difficult, but doable. One word. What's yours? This idea comes from a Tribune reader named May. She prefers not to publicize her last name, who first wrote to me in the dearly departed year of 2014 to say that she chooses one word annually to help her steer through the time ahead. Last year, her word was acceptance. May emailed again recently to announce that she has chosen this year's word. My word for 2015 is completion, she wrote. Completion of one task at a time, completion of professional goals, completion of finding lost family members. Completion is a big tent of a word, but that's one thing I like about May's word for the year plan. Her challenge is clear, no clutter. In its difficult way, it's very simple. Unlike a long list of resolutions, that 25-point annual plan for achieving the perfect you, May's challenge invites a person to focus. And while May has thought about particular ways completion can apply to her life, the details follow from the larger goal. May's challenge calls for discipline, a consideration of your true desires as opposed to your passing fancies. Pick one. But of all the words in the world, which word? Change, mused a friend when I presented her with the word for the year challenge. She didn't mean she wanted to change her whole life. She enjoys her life, but as she gets older, she feels more bound by routine, less likely on any given day to do something unpredictable. Her routines are pleasant or useful, sometimes both. The kind that keep a life humming along, that gets the bills paid and protects the average morning from turning into a black hole of uncertainty. But still she'd like to stretch the boundaries, be more impetuous and adventuresome the way she was when she was younger. "Well, said another friend to whom I presented May's challenge to pick a word. My friend said, "I like May's words, but since she took those, I'll go with grow." Grow. For the last decade, I've been watching my kids grow while I've been treading water. I don't even keep my own scrapbook anymore. And by the way, I've never had one. But they have beautiful scrapbooks. I want to grow into my new identity at work. I want to grow as a mother. I want to grow as a wife. I want to grow a sunflower in our front yard. Last year, we let our garden go to the bad place. I want to grow my retirement account. Most of all, she says, I want to grow still. Still. To really meditate instead of spending all my free time on physical activity. Acceptance, completion, change, grow. And then the writer Schmidt from the Tribune says, I could accept any of those words as my assignment for 2015, but I've continued to search for my own word. I've been like the shopper roaming around the Super Target, picking up objects, setting them down, and heading off to the next aisle and in pursuit of something better, sure that I'll recognize the perfect thing when I see it. Courage, that's a good word, useful in any year. But is it the best word for this year? Health, always a good goal, but is it the best choice for me this year? Patience, sure. Perseverance, joyful effort. Those are all tempting, even if the last one is two words. My editor would probably like me to choose deadline. I think I've finally settled on a word which I'll keep to myself because I may change my mind. That's another great thing about the Word for the Year challenge. According to my rules, once you've picked your word, you have through the month of January to change it. So what is your word? What's going to be a brick upon which to build your house, your temple of the Holy Spirit, built upon the foundation of Jesus Christ? What one word will help lead you into faithful discipleship with Jesus, love and community with your brothers and sisters, even your enemies? What is the word that God is putting on your heart today? For me, at least until the end of the month, is thrive. That God has meant us not just to survive, but has made us to thrive. I believe that could be a word for St. John's. I don't know. Listen for what one word God wants for you. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Our hymn is number 438, Forth in Thy Name, O Lord. May we stand. Jesus, hope, health, joy. One word. May God give you that word. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.